The Hairy Bikers are back, and this time we are going west.
We've been on the road in search of the world's best food stories for more than 20 years.
But after my recent struggles, it looked like our adventures could be over.
When I was told I was ill, I never thought I'd ride a motorcycle again.
There's a spirit of Dave that I've always loved.
And we're doing it.
We are, mate, we're here.
On this trip...
Can I come up here and have a shot?
Absolutely.
Yes!
We'll be revisiting some of the places that have meant so much to us in the past.
It's funny, it takes me back here when I was young and thrusting.
I beg your pardon?
And sampling the best food on offer.
Like a biblical.
While making some new friends along the way.
Ooh. How is it?
Yes, I love that sound.
It's going to be a trip of a lifetime.
Being here today with you, it's not just light, mate.
No, no.
It's a bloody searchlight.
As we go west.
Hey, it's been amazing.
It has, bro.
It has.
It has.
Mwah. Love you.
Our westward journey has now brought us cruising along the 220-mile River Severn, a gem steeped in history and natural beauty.
It's where the river meets the sea, and the fusion of flavours on offer here from the local area are something to behold.
After a stunning ride, we're heading towards Newport and Bristol. These cities are a melting pot of culinary delights and a vibrant food scene.
But also are surrounded by a few of the most beautiful views the West Country has to offer.
When was it you first came to Bristol?
I was 19.
Right.
Sailed with a load of underprivileged kids up and down the Severn.
Were you one of the underprivileged kids?
No, I was there trying to stop them drowning.
There you go.
It was great. When did you come? God, it must have been years.
40 years ago, I came to work at BBC Bristol and I was working as an assistant on Moonfleet. You know, Sunday afternoon dramas.
Yeah.
It was lovely, and eventually I got married here, and I did a lot of work here. Casualty was always a bit of bread and butter. It's funny, it takes me back here when I was young and thrusting instead of old and jaded.
I beg your pardon?
Yeah, no.
You keep your thrusting to yourself.
It's a thrill to be revisiting some of our old haunts. And we're starting our journey round the Severn Estuary by crossing its iconic bridge and heading to Newport.
Nestled by the River Usk, this medieval market town was a powerhouse during the Industrial Revolution, and the history of that still echoes through its streets, from the Transporter Bridge to the castle.
Our first stop, a new food mecca in the heart of the city, the 150-year-old Newport Market.
This is why we're here.
An extraordinary street food stall known as Bab House, boasting an all-female team keen to satisfy the cravings of eager customers.
Hello.
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 Are you still serving?
Oh, hello. For you.
Are we too late?
Welcome to Bab House.
The team are really making a name for themselves with a menu inspired by their travels abroad and Layli's heritage.
That you started with Persian cuisine because your dad's Iranian.
That's right. Bab House originally was a Middle Eastern street food concept.
Right.
And we've adapted it because of our love of Mexican cuisine. The two cultures are really similar, the two food cultures, and they easily blend together.
You're what we would call a proper chef. I mean, you've got a really good kind of food heritage, you know, like Jamie Oliver 15 and Waitrose. You know what you're talking about.
Becky and I met working in London, and we share like a huge love of food, Mexican food, and have spent a lot of time traveling around America and the West Coast.
Mm-hmm.
And so have my sisters. And that's where... So it's basically kind of a meeting of minds.
So should we Would you mind, could you feed us, please?
Absolutely.
The girls have now established two successful restaurants in the area. And looking at the menu, you can see why.
OK, so we're going to make some birria tacos for you.
OK.
First things first, cheese.
What sort?
This is mozzarella and cheddar. Birria stew is Mexican.
Mexican.
But what the Americans have done in LA is add cheese. So, corn taco shells.
Yes, yeah.
So
lovely.
These get dipped into. So, this is beef fat. So, then you basically just will wait until that gets nice and crispy. We can turn it over. So, we serve this with consomme. So, the idea is when you guys sit down in a second.
It's a really good looking broth, isn't it?
Dunk her in.
Get in.
So, we make our own hot sauce and then just like to garnish bits with a bit of pickled onion and some pickled jalapenos.
Beautiful.
As well.
Good old-fashioned Welsh cooking, eh?
I know, this is the first place we've landed, yeah. So it's like, this is great.
What we do is we flip our tacos over, so then you get, like, this lush cheese crust around the outside.
We make everything from scratch, as Becky said. The salsa roja is a chili salsa made with guajillo chilies.
Guajillo, yeah, lovely.
Which are kind of like sweet and smoky. The beef that we have here is ex-dairy. This is Welsh beef. From Pembrokeshire, the fat that you get is so golden, it's like butter.
It's inspiring to see this young team embracing local products and crafting everything themselves.
OK, so I'm just going to finish it off with a little bit more coriander and some tahini.
Tacos with beef consomme in hot sauce, testament to these chefs bringing a fusion of flavours to the heart of Newport.
Oh, don't forget to dip.
Mm. Oh, that's so good. That's ridiculous, isn't it?
Mm. So the hot sauce is house-made. We do ferment the chilies. It's about an 18-month process.
Wow.
And we burp them every couple of weeks.
Yeah, they get a good...
And I bet you do that, don't you?
Baby.
What's next?
So we're going to do our California corn ribs.
Wow.
So it's kind of like this sweet, spicy. You've got the sour from the lime and the tahini.
The girls deep fry the corn ribs for around 2 minutes.
Woo! So it does pop. It's literally like popcorn.
Now they're golden, they're seasoned with garlic powder, Cajun seasoning and salt, then dressed with Manchego cheese. Finally finishing with watermelon and pomegranate.
This is really fine dining for street food, may I say.
It is.
Yeah.
That's so tasty.
Oh, man, they're properly good.
It is fast food, but it's it kind of still so tasty and complex.
I mean, I'm not being greedy, but what's next?
I'm now going to prepare for you guys our kind of Middle Eastern fusion dish. So this is lamb tostada. So tostada is fried corn tortilla. Mm-hmm. So you've got that nice crunch. So this is called mizagosami. So this is a Persian dip. It's actually my favourite dish. My grandmother taught me how to make this.
Layli smokes the aubergines, then roasts with tomato, garlic and saffron to make the dip, which she then generously applies to the tostadas.
So the lamb has been lightly smoked and then slowly braised with Persian dried limes and fenugreek. The idea from this dish is taken from a Persian stew called gorma zabzi, which is slow braised lamb with herbs.
Oh, it smells good.
It does, doesn't it?
Yeah.
It's the aubergine I think we're getting.
Yeah.
So just a little bit of the yogurt, so the sourness from the yogurt will cut through the rich fattiness of the meat. And in this bottle, I've got zug. This is made with a little bit of cardamom and lemon juice instead of lime juice, with the coriander as well. And this just lifts the dish. All right, gents, here we go.
Back crunch.
That's insane.
That's fusion score, that is
fantastic.
Three great dishes from creative chefs whose work truly underscores how the people of Newport embrace innovation in food.
Women of the taco world, rock on. These are absolutely fantastic.
This street food stall has introduced us to a fantastic fusion of food cultures truly inspiring us with their flavours of the future.
It's amazing what they've done with this business. With imagination, hard work, the young women with amazing sense of ambition. It's just wonderful.
Really, really inventive food. A kind of fusion mix between the Persian and Mexican cuisines. And I'm thinking, really, how is that going to work? Unbelievably good.
Those flavours have given us an idea of a dish of our own. But first, we're tracking the river 25 miles northwards, saying goodbye to Wales with our sights set on a very particular product in Gloucestershire.
Netherend Farm is famous for its delicious butter. Its legacy as a dairy farm dating back to 1936, when the roots of the family business were first planted. We're hoping owners Wyndham and Linda can show us something a bit special to cook with.
Yeah, it's funny because we feel we know you because of the butter. You know, many of the time at hotels, if we see a little thick, posh pat of butter, it's Netherend Farm.
Good.
My father moved into the village about 1936. As things moved on with putting in the pasteuriser, we built up the business. People started wanting semi-skim and skim.
Oh,
and, of course, we had the cream over then from doing the skim and semi-skim.
Of course.
Yeah. My mum said, you can make butter easy. She said, and I just started off in the Kenwood. A chap from London came down, a distributor in London, and he said, your butter's delicious, I can sell this in London. And he told us how to pack it, didn't he?
Yeah, that's right.
And it took off from there.
The high-quality butter business was a hit, with the farm now supplying top-notch restaurants and five-star hotels.
To get this natural product, they churn pure cream, allowing the fats to separate from the liquid, which yields a rich, creamy butter, which is then shaped, packed, and cooled.
But perhaps their greatest achievement is they've been working this farm as man and wife for almost half a century.
I think the honeymoon period might be over, do you know what I mean?
We've been married 50 years.
There's another 2 weeks, days. So we another may not make it.
No, it's touch and go whether
that's your golden wedding.
Yeah. Wow.
They might have an established business, but this couple continue to innovate with their new luxury product, the nutty clarified butter ghee.
I just thought there must be something else we can do as well as butter.
Yeah.
Ghee looks
health.
It's a healthy fat. I just started making it in a tiny little kettle, didn't we?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Ghee is used in South Asian and Indian cuisine, but it's growing more popular here due to its vitamin content and being lactose free. I reckon it could just be the thing we're looking for.
Oh, that's a lot of butter.
Oh, look at this. Hello, Hazel.
Hi, Hazel.
Hello.
You look really busy. We'll not shake your hand.
OK. So we put our fresh butter into the kettle.
Mm-hmm.
When it's melted, we turn the heat up. Moisture starts evaporating. So this now will be cooking, simmering away for about 4 to 6 hours. And then the milk solids caramelise, sink to the bottom, and then we get the lovely clear liquid.
You get that lovely caramelised taste too by the cooking.
It's nutty, isn't it?
Yeah.
It's a nutty flavour. So beautiful. Yeah. And it's great because it's, in essence, handmade. What a wonderful thing to do.
Yeah.
Well, we know about, you know, ghee, the use in Southeast Asian cookery, but what would you use it for apart from that?
Well, we use it on our roast potatoes.
That's a genius idea, isn't it?
Fluffy. Yeah. Parboiled potatoes, just coat them with some ghee, and it's lovely crispy on the outside.
Ghee has a smoke point of 250 degrees Celsius, 100 degrees more than butter, making it the perfect product for high-temperature cooking without compromising its nutritional benefits or flavour.
Is there any way we can look at it in its warm state? You know, look at your liquid gold and it's...
Over there.
After hours of simmering, the water has evaporated and the milk solids are collected at the bottom, leaving the clear liquid to be carefully strained.
Oh, so this
is golden, isn't it? Yeah. Looks like golden syrup.
Totally changed, doesn't it?
Completely. Yeah.
So then we decant it into the jug and put it straight into the jars.
Oh, look at that colour.
And that's the liquid gold.
Mr. Myers.
All right, thank you.
Over to you. Look at that.
Beautiful. The smell is lovely.
Go on, dude, fill another two. You never know. We might be able to get them out of here without Wyndham and Linda.
But the final check, does it taste as good as it looks? Look at that.
Thank you, sir. Oh, man. Oh, that is really good.
Yeah.
I can't wait to cook with it now.
Well, we came looking for a special ingredient, and I'd say that was yet another mission accomplished.
Great product, handmade, distributed from where it was manufactured. I think it's marvellous.
Sometimes the stuff I've bought in cans, it doesn't taste buttery and rich like this does. It's a wonderful product, and I can't wait to get started cooking with it.
Discovering a fast food fusion and the most perfect ghee has inspired us to whip up an exotic meal with a touch of luxury. Chipotle prawn tacos.
Oh, this is pure prawnography, isn't it?
It is. Look at this, man. Yeah.
First up, we have 500 grams of succulent peeled prawns.
That's what I reckon. If we combine the ghee with this inspiration of Mexico from Newport, we'll have the best tacos ever.
Well, look, I'm going to start with a marinade. So I've got some chipotle paste, I've got some ancho paste. Now, these are anchos. And ancho in Spanish means wide, because they are.
They are wide and flat.
So ancho chili, not particularly hot, about 1,000 to 2,000 scobels. You know how they measure.
Oh, yes.
You know, I'm fully used to this information, mate.
Take the ancho chilies. Give them a good crush and mix with a teaspoon of olive oil and 2 teaspoons of chipotle paste.
You cannot have a taco without some form of chocolate in it. So this is cocoa powder. And then some light, soft brown sugar.
Now comes the zesty twist. Grab a lime and add the zest and the juice.
That's the thing about street food. It's a multi-century experience, isn't it? Well, I need to compliment this, really. I'm going to do it like a sexy coleslaw, Kingy. Look, I've just got a pointy cabbage, you know, sweetheart.
Yeah.
Shredded very, very finely with carrot. And this has been salted to get the water out.
Now, I want a proper kick with this coleslaw, so I'm adding 1 habanero chilli.
I'm cutting the seeds out of these habanero chilies,
yeah.
Kingy, because this will be infinitely off the Scoble scale compared to your anchos.
Hot stuff! Now for a big spoon of sour cream.
You could use half fat, but I think we're looking rather trim at the minute.
Mm.
And some onion powder and garlic powder.
And the Mexican oregano.
Regular oregano will still work its magic if you're not feeling as pedantic as us. And to round off this flavour fiesta, give your coleslaw a splash of cider apple vinegar.
Let's have a mix-up. Yeah, go have a taste of this. Oh, I'll leave it to you, you're the connoisseur.
Whoa, man.
Yeah. It's just, you see, a few simple ingredients, you can take, like, some like coleslaw, and make it really, really interesting. Now the salsa, this is a really simple one, Kingy.
Yeah, go on.
Just a bit of life.
Lush.
I've got a mango here, which I've diced to perfection.
Toss in some diced red onion to the mango party. Then add some zing with lime juice and zest. Finally, add a shower of chopped coriander for a burst of freshness.
That's the salsa, that's the coleslaw.
Well, we're cracking eggs with sticks here.
Now it's on to the ghee. So, big dollop, Kingy.
Look at that, beautiful.
Mm. So, you know, I thought for the tacos, a bit like doing naan breads, you put ghee to soften them and enrich them.
Yeah.
So I thought, one by one, I'll just kind of toast them lightly to soften them. They used to be really rich and make use of that ghee.
Lovely. Yeah, grand.
And, you know, this ghee is so good for your immune system because it's full of butyric acid.
Ooh.
Yeah.
What's butyric acid?
Good for your immune system.
All right. I'm going to take the prawns out of the marinade, overcrowd the pan, and then just toss them. And I might do that in batches, actually. quite quick. I just want them to go pink.
It's toasting time, and these tacos are in for a bath of sizzling ghee.
Look at those.
Ooh, nice.
Now just chuck them onto your taco rack. Well, that is if you've got one.
God, it's quick, isn't it?
It is quick. I'll tell you what I'm going to do, mate. I'm going to reduce this liquor slightly, just to get it thick so it sticks to the prawns. I'll put the prawns back into the pan, and then we're ready to go for the assembly.
Yep, yummers.
With the prawns cooked, they're ready to serve.
And I'll build the tacos with a bed of coleslaw, topped with prawns and a dash of the marinade, and finally crowned with a healthy serving of the salsa.
Yes, look at that.
Inspired by our trips to Newport in Gloucestershire, will our own special hairy biker take on tacos hit the spot? You betcha.
This is exciting.
Bit of lime.
The taco is a perfect vehicle for getting said contents into your gob, isn't it?
It is, isn't it?
Oh, jackpot! What I love about this, it's a simple, quick recipe that you could do every day of the week, but that sauce you made is enriched with a ghee.
Mm.
It's rich and lovely,
it is.
And it works.
Riding west, the rolling hills and winding roads make for a great road trip.
And who would have thought? The West Country's home to one of the oldest products in British culinary history. Something most of us in the UK have kept as a staple in our cupboard since medieval times. Mustard.
We're meeting Samantha in the historic town of Tewkesbury to discover the flavour of medieval mustard and what made it so popular.
Sam?
Hello.
I'm Si. Very nice to meet you.
Sam, I'm Dave.
Nice to meet you.
The reason we've come to meet you is you're the sole person that's making Tewkesbury mustard balls, and this really is one of the oldest products in British culinary history.
That's right.
So what's growing there, Sam?
So this is basically my white gourd. This is what I use in Tewkesbury mustard. It's the key ingredient, which is mustard and horseradish. So English mustard, it has to have fire. And if it doesn't blow your head off, it's not English mustard.
Medieval mustard packs a punch. But why make it so fiery?
Well, it used to be said that it was used to cover the taste of meats that were on the turn, essentially, because people that would have picked up mustard and gone from town to town would have been on a horse.
Right.
So whatever they were carrying was what they were carrying, so most things were sort of on the turn. The women of Tewkesbury would have made them out and they would have been dried on racks, and any passerbyers would have picked them up and taken them wherever they were going on their travels.
Right.
If you think it was mentioned in Shakespeare, and for something to be mentioned in Shakespeare of that time, it must have been something that people were familiar with.
How did it all start for you then, Sam? Quite an odd thing to get into.
I met a gentleman, an elderly gentleman, in the deli that I was working in. And when I came back to his house, he sat at the table and told me all about it. And I was actually quite gobsmacked that nobody in Tewkesbury was doing it. And I just felt like somebody didn't need to take it by the balls, you know?
Yeah.
Quite literally. We set up a company, and within a few months, we got a lot of interest and we were selling a lot of mustard. And yeah, then Robin decided to retire.
Okay.
And so I took on, and I've been doing it myself since.
But you never thought you'd end up being the queen of the mustard balls.
I really didn't.
So, Sam, we're going to get some horseradish and give it a go.
Yeah, let's get some horseradish. You guys can grate it up for me.
Great.
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 Wow.
So, yeah, this is the root here. And essentially, all you put back in is this, and then it will just continue to grow again.
Quite exciting.
Best straight from the ground.
Nice
Doesn't
and fresh.
Get better.
Come with me, guys.
To the kitchen to learn the secrets of this traditional recipe and how it differs from today.
So you've got mustard seeds.
Yep.
Horseradish. So we're going to need someone to grate the horseradish first. If you can do that side. And this is a cannibal. So the woman of Tewkesbury would have ground down the seed to a fine flour, removing the husk. And then they would have just used the flour to mix with the horseradish.
With a cannonball.
With a cannonball, yeah.
So you just...
A lot of them about then, weren't there?
typical yellow mustard is often mellowed by boiling in water and adding sweetness.
I'm going to be here a while.
Sam, however, mixes her mustard with something a little stronger.
Is this doing anything?
Nope.
But it should be like this. This is what we use to make the mustard balls. So with this, however, we will stick that in cider and then that will be rested for about 48 hours.
Right.
But nice. It is as really simple nice. As literally taking the horseradish into a bowl and then steeping it with cider, which is there.
Combined as our ancestors would have done with readily available ingredients.
Squeeze the horseradish out completely and remove all of the fibres. Yeah. There'll be no fibres left in the end product, as it were. And that actually goes into sausages, so nothing's wasted. So, should we make some balls?
Yep.
We mix mustard powder with a little of our creamy cider mix. We then continue to add the cider until we achieve a dough-like consistency.
Ooh, well done.
Hands in.
Hands in, as you would if you were making bread. I find it quite therapeutic.
Mm. It's quite pungent.
Yeah. But there you go. That's it. And then you just take it off, weigh it out, roll it up.
Dried for preservation, this condiment is fit for a king, with Henry VIII indulging in gold leaf-covered mustard balls like these during his visit to Tewkesbury in 1535. But will this mustard pass the muster?
So do we taste it now?
So it is edible, but I wouldn't recommend it. It is recommended that you take a piece of the ball and you mix it with any kind of beer, wine, cider, vinegar, right. Anything you like the flavour of. Obviously, we wouldn't touch water because it's a product that's come from medieval England, essentially. Yes. So water would have been associated with the plagues.
And who said English food was bland?
No, it's definitely not bland. I mean, if anything, it's just been forgotten about a little bit. So we're going to try some with some balsamic vinegar.
Ooh.
And we'll have it on some crackers. You just cut a sliver of the ball and then take a teaspoon of the balsamic and then you just want to work it into it. Lovely. Here we go. As much or as little as you like. Cheers.
Cheers.
Well, thank you, Sam.
Cheers, thank you. Mmm.
Oh, it's great.
Oh, yeah. It's got real fire, but just enough.
Mmm. You should get the sweetness first, the vinegar taste, and then the horseradish after.
But it's a warmth rather than a heat.
A taste of history kept alive today by Sam in a small kitchen in Tewkesbury.
Well, I think we should take some.
A couple of bowls back.
Thank you, madam.
Thank you.
British, fiery, and most importantly, versatile. These mustard balls can be mixed with any flavour we desire to elevate our next dish on our amazing journey west.
What's lovely about it is there's a young woman who is passionate about the history of food. It's lovely that she's keeping that fundamental tradition alive.
We found another pocket of food history and, dare we say, kind of a little gem. And as a cook, I find it gives me inspiration, you know. I want to take my mustard balls off and be proud.
Time to rock over to Bristol. Following the River Severn south and enjoying some beautiful scenery on the way.
Bristol has gone through quite the transformation since my younger days, and it's a real pleasure to see how the city and the food scene has developed.
With around 90 different languages spoken here, all these different cultures have created a huge range of restaurants to cater for all tastes. And we're starting with one of the newest additions.
We'd heard of a cook who's brought her family recipes all the way from East Africa and want to discover the secret that's made the city fall in love with her restaurant.
Thank you, dear heart.
Yes, very pleasant.
Yes.
We're meeting Iman, the cook behind Jaconi, and her partner James, who helps to run the restaurant.
What an amazing smell, guys.
It's fantastic. It is.
Thank you.
What I love about this place I don't know anything about East African food. I have to admit that so many things on the menu are a mystery.
You're in the right place, especially when it comes to Bristol. Tikuni means kitchen in Swahili, and this is an East African kitchen where we represent Ethiopian, Somalian, Kenyan and Tanzanian cuisine.
What about Nairobi as well, Iman? Is that like the centre of...
That's it. That's the centre of where you find all of East African food. That's where I grew up, and that's where you get... It's the heaven for all of East African cuisine.
Iman learned to cook at just 8 years old, under the guidance of her mother and auntie. She cooks traditional East African cuisine.
How did the restaurant start here?
Oh, the restaurant came about when James and I met back in 2017, and then I started making some East African cuisine for James. And we did a few pop-ups. The first one was horrendous. Everybody loved the food. It was just the service and everything was just ridiculous. And then we had our first stint at St. Nicholas Market, mm-hmm. which is a street food mm-hmm. market that in Bristol. We've opened this place about 18 months ago.
Since opening, the restaurant is thriving, and Iman is keen to ensure the East African dining experience remains true to its core.
We do a lot of traditional stuff. So today I'm going to show you how to make ugali.
Ugali?
Ugali.
Like many cultures, East African diners often don't use cutlery. So we are eating with ungali, a dense cornmeal or maize porridge used to scoop meats, rice, stews, or anything else that's served, really.
Are we in the kitchen?
Yes, please, come on.
We'll be back with a feast, Dave. You just get to grips with Jaconi's coffee game.
Ugali is like the rice of a lot of East Africans that goes with every dish.
And what is it?
So it's made from maize meal.
Okay, so it's corn-based.
It's corn, yes.
Brilliant.
So you get some water here. Look, oh, that was already ready. Just do that, sizzling away.
Okay.
Drop a bit of salt. I don't measure anything.
No, so just by eye.
Little bit of oil. So it doesn't stick to the bottom.
So you're just sprinkling it on and then just agitate the water so it goes in. Okay, fantastic.
Save that for me. And then we get more ugali.
Oh, wow. It thickens pretty quick, doesn't it?
Yes. And then you add more as you go. See, now when you get that consistency, that's where we stop adding any more.
Okay.
And you bring it together. There you go.
Hey, this is fab.
Oh, wow, you're doing amazing. How? Wow, Simon, you're doing that like my aunties do.
I'm doing it like your auntie.
Well, I think
it's much the same as bringing together a nice mashed potato with some. Come on, then.
There you go. So, now we do this. We create this little ball here together.
And that just softens the grain.
Yes. It lets the water take in. You turn it way down. If I can touch, there you go. So if
it's still slightly gritty, isn't it?
There you go. So leave that for 10 minutes to steam.
Okay.
Let it do its thing.
Don't worry, mate, you enjoy your brew while Iman and I crack on with the cooking.
I'm going to take a second to do the rest of the platter, put it together.
Okay, perfect. Well, look, I'm here to help, so anything you need me to do, just shout. Okay.
Brilliant.
But I will be watching closely because it's fascinating.
Rice with peppers, currants and fried onions are put onto the plate. Alongside kachumbara, a fresh African salad.
You've got cloves.
Yes.
Cardamom.
Oh, wow, quite a lot of cloves, eh?
Yeah, cinnamon.
Yeah.
And fenugreek.
Ginger, coriander, chilli, holy basil are all added to an array of spices used to prepare the goat stew. And Somalian goat chops with bisbas, a green chilli and garlic hot sauce for dipping.
Oh, is it done? Yep.
Oh, what about the crispy bits?
There you go. There it is. It's stuck on there. Well, I'm going to put on the crispy bit on top of it.
Oh, yes. You see?
Yes.
You're a class act.
The ungali is added to the feast. And it's time for us to enjoy the authentic African cuisine right here in Bristol.
Hey, oh, you're in for a treat. Oh. Look at this.
Alrighty.
All right.
What have we here?
What you have here is this plate represents what Jikoni is. So you've got zigni, which is the one of the traditional dishes to be made by Ethiopian and Eritreans.
Yeah.
Berbera spice blend, which is the unique spice blend. And then here's the centerpiece, Somalian style of cooking goat meat. Oh.
And we eat with our hands.
Ugali.
Right, okay. So you pinch.
You pinch, you roll it into a bowl. So a nice bowl, yes, and then put a thumbprint in it and then pick what you want to do.
Mmm.
Good.
Ooh, that's tasty. I like that.
OK, let's see what Simon does. OK. He's doing the proper African auntie thing now.
Oh, look at that, eh?
I'm an African auntie. Oh, my God.
That was it.
And then you move on to the next dish.
These are chops, so you might want to really get involved with those ones.
OK, there we go. No, eat it like an auntie, Simon. Come on, you're an auntie.
OK.
There you go.
Tasty.
Good? Loving it.
Yeah.
Oh, that is unbelievably good.
This is my mama's and my auntie's teaching for me. And that's what you're tasting today. So thank you.
And then?
Simon? No.
Pretty sure a lot of that went down your shirt. But...
OK.
There's nothing better than sharing a table of food with friends. Or in this case, a plate.
Thank you so much. Thank you for joining us.
Asante sana.
New friends or old, it doesn't matter. Because in Bristol, when it comes to food, there's always something new to try.
For me, being a greedy foodie, I think I found a new food culture at my age. I thought I'd been around the block a few times. In terms of our cooking, I think Si and I need to experiment more.
We didn't know much about that cuisine, and it's just been a lovely experience to be exposed to it. It's fabulous.
Traditional, hearty and rich. The food at Ciccone has inspired us to make a feast that brings people together. And we feel we have the perfect dish in mind, chicken yassa.
Dish from Senegal. Well, they cook a variety of it all over Africa.
It's kind of like a marinade, it's marinated meat.
Yeah, but it's so flavoursome and it's got heat and it's got passion. Well, should I do the marinade and you do the cooking?
Yeah, go on then.
Could you bring me a bowl, dear boy?
Yes, I will, I will.
The engine room of the yassa.
Oh, well, while you're doing that, then, I'll cut four onions.
Oh, I have a lot of onions in this. I've grated this onion, which I think is the right thing to do for a marinade.
Definitely.
To build the flavour, we have a chunk of grated ginger and those flavour champions, four cloves of garlic.
I'm fascinated with this Tewkesbury mustard ball. But now I'm not sure how much to use of this, so what I'll do is I'm just going to dissolve a little bit in some red wine vinegar. Then we can taste it, see how hot it is. Have a taste of this. Trust your judgment, not that I'm scared of it.
I think a bit of salt.
Oh, that'll be all right then.
Yeah.
Yeah, all right then.
The Kingy seal of approval means it goes in. And if you can't get your hands on a mustard ball, a couple of teaspoons of Dijon will do just fine. Next, add two or three tablespoonfuls of lemon juice to add zing and to dial up the flavour according to your taste.
Now, that's what you call a marinade. Now, if this didn't have enough flavour, I'm going to finely chop a Scotch bonnet chilli in it.
I love Scotch bonnet because although they have the heat there, they're still full of flavour and pepper.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, lovely.
There you go, mon ami.
Into the marinade go those chicken thighs, skin on, bone in, ready to take the flavours we've crafted.
Just get in there and just rub it in. Just push those flavours through that meat. And then, preferably, overnight, you need to marinate that in the fridge. Everybody at home will be pleased to know that you did one before, so happy days.
Aye.
And here is the said chicken.
Shake off the excess marinade and pat dry, because we want a lovely golden colour on the chicken breasts when we fry them later.
Don't throw away the marinade, because this, we're going to use that, aren't we?
Thick gravy.
Thick gravy.
In Senegal, serving chicken yassa to guests was a gesture of warm hospitality. It was often eaten without cutlery, using only your right hand, never the left, which was reserved for cleaning.
What should we have with it?
I've found the old jumbo couscous. But you know, it's not couscous at all. It's pasta balls that have been roasted.
See.
And it was developed in Israel in a food shortage in 1950 when they didn't get any rice. But it's really, really nice. So I just need to simmer this for about 15 minutes.
While you're managing that, mate, I'll cook the chicken thighs skin side down till they're that perfect golden brown. Then I'll flip and cook for a few more minutes. Remember to let your chicken get to room temperature before you cook it.
Oh, that's what you want. Sun-kissed, isn't it?
Because that caramelization, as we well know, is all about flavor, isn't it?
So... yeah. The chicken is all set and ready to make its grand entrance. And wouldn't you know, my couscous is also on point, so I'll drain and let it cool.
And I'll sauté these onions with a couple of bay leaves, Dave. Low to medium heat should do it until rich and golden brown. It's important to get these quite caramelised.
Yeah, it's cooled down nicely. How's your onions? Oh, look at that.
Get in.
Could be from a burger van. In goes the marinade.
I like this, Dave, because none of the ingredients goes to waste and none of the flavours. It's great.
Nope. You'll even eat the pattern off the plate afterwards. It's so good.
And then the chicken.
Pour some chicken stock into the pan. Then on goes the lid. Bring to the boil and cook. After 10 minutes, remove the lid until the sauce is reduced down and the chicken is cooked through. You can add a little sugar to sweeten the sauce if you fancy.
Meanwhile, I'm working on the salad. I'm giving the couscous some love with a drizzle of olive oil, letting it fluff up to perfection. Then in go some red peppers, spring onions, and some red onion for that extra crunch and colour.
So far, we've got six onions in this dish.
Salt?
If you like. And some chilli flakes. And now some lemon juice.
A bit of pepper too. And you can't forget the flat leaf parsley.
It's traditional, but unusual. I'm pitting green olives going now.
Time to bring it all together. We've managed to combine those wonderful English and African flavours.
Chicken's cooked perfectly. You always had a touch with fire. That's because you're from Newcastle.
It does help, say.
Yeah. The marinade's gone perfectly through the chicken.
The mustard and the chilli, it's really good.
You put some sugar in as well to temper the acidity.
Yeah.
And it does work. It's beautifully balanced. 30 years now we've been mates. The past 20 years we've been on the road going around the world.
Yeah.
But you never stop learning about food.
Never.
It's a continually unfolding adventure. But the nice thing is, you get to enjoy, you get to eat it and taste it.
Really good.
My new journey to the West Country would unlock a diverse range of dishes with a fusion of flavours. But what about the simple pleasures Bristol has to offer?
Cookies are a popular treat that are available almost everywhere. But one bakery in Bristol has a secret formula to the perfect cookie every time. And our mission is to find out how.
Oh, it smells brilliant.
Doesn't it?
This is not just baking, you know, this is cake couture.
What's that mean?
Posh.
Oh, right.
We've set out to meet Anna, the brilliant mind behind Anna Cake Couture. Her delectable creations have been making waves throughout the Bristol food scene.
So I started making wedding cakes in a little shop in St George in Bristol on my own. I was there for 7 years. And after getting that going, me and my partner decided to open the cafe cake shop in Clifton.
Right.
You started off with 5 members of staff and it just gradually grew and here we are with quite a large 24 team.
Talk about a powerhouse, and their success is a testament to the triumph of local British baking. And it's gotten even sweeter. They've also set up a stall in Newport Market.
Yeah. Did you ever dream you'd own a bakery this big?
No, absolutely not. I started baking from a really young age with my grandma, and I just never stopped. I was never very very good at drawing or anything like that, but I could pick up an icing bag and I could just do it. And then you get to eat it at the end, which is the best bit.
Anna has won several awards for her cakes already, but her business has grown to feature many delicious products.
We make thousands of macarons.
Wow.
Yeah. Beautiful colours, beautiful flavours.
Yeah.
But cookies are the ones people keep coming back for.
Can we have a look around, Anna?
Yeah, I'd love to show you.
Oh, great. We'll follow you.
Great.
Can we eat cake?
Yeah, of course.
Absolutely.
It's high time to get a glimpse into the heart of the operation, where the baking comes to life.
It's like a magic Willy Wonka land.
Too right, and we're going to get stuck in with the cookies. We're meeting Emma and Beth, two of the expert bakers on Anna's team.
This is our bestseller.
The big one.
Oh, yeah, the big one.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow, fantastic. So how do we start?
So we are going to mix the butter and two sugars together, and then we're going to pile in lots of chocolate. We've got some caramelised white chocolate here that we made.
How do you caramelise white chocolate?
It's really simple. Just have good quality white chocolate, and you just want to warm it slowly until it just starts to increase the darker colour.
Now it's time for the dough, which consists of self-raising flour, eggs, butter and sugar.
We try and keep our supplies as local as possible, so we get all our eggs and butter local. But things like chocolate, you just got to get the best quality.
Of course.
In goes the chunky chocolate, which will break down in the mixer, followed by salt and baking powder.
You must be really rightly proud because you've got the girls here that are doing their thing and, you know, it's a younger generation, so you're passing all that skill on.
It's great. We've got a team of 24 people and I think it's 23 girls, actually. Oh, yeah.
How brilliant is that? Get in.
Why are there no blokes?
Yeah. I don't know. Maybe they don't want to work with us. We want them.
Well, so it's not intentional.
No, not at all.
The chocolate is beginning to caramelise.
Put your finger in and have a go.
You first.
Oh, yeah. Oh, wow, yeah.
When it goes crumbly around the edges in particular, if you give it a really good stir, the smoother it is going through, the smoother it is when it's set in a block.
All right, time to shape up those cookies.
So ours are particularly chunky and they've got big chunks of things in them. And when they're freshly baked, you can open them and you can see the insides oozing. So a bit chewy on the outside and soft in the middle.
A bit soft. Oh, wow. Yeah.
So we weigh 125 grams.
Spot on.
And then we give it a little roll in a ball.
And then we freeze them. So when they go into the oven, they go in frozen and they slowly start to bake. But by having them frozen, the centre doesn't bake quite so much.
Gotcha.
Keeps that really soft, gooey middle.
I can't wait to give it a try.
125 grams.
Ooh. Crumbs.
No pun intended.
Oh, 50 grams out.
It's quite therapeutic, this.
So I think we put these in the freezer now.
Get them in the cold, Kingy. Pronto.
Don't sweat, mate. There are some already baking in the oven for us to try.
So these have just come out of the oven.
Fabulous. Very generous.
Wish everybody had smell-o-vision at home because it's so great. It
smells wonderful.
Smell here.
Yeah.
It's time for my favourite part of baking, the tasting.
Oh.
Do you want a bit?
Of course I do. Thank you, that is a bit. I love the strata of the white chocolate through it.
No, to be fair, they're fantastic.
No, it's soft. Yeah. It's enough of a cake to be cakey and satisfying.
Caramelised white chocolate. Fantastic flavour to it.
It's good, isn't it?
It's a proper treat, isn't it?
Real treat.
If you're feeling kind of miserable, it'll cheer you up. Feeling cold, it'd make you feel warm. If you got it as a gift, you'd feel loved.
Nailed it, you lot, haven't you?
Yeah.
It's great.
Tasting these cookies from a local bakery is a sweet reminder that simple joys and shared moments can truly touch the soul. These cookies, baked with love, carry a piece of this beautiful city with them, as do I.
What we're seeing in this part of the world is people applying themselves creatively and endeavouring to go forward with a great business. I think it's fab.
I did feel like I wandered into this wonderful kind of Willy Wonka chocolate cake factory. And it's funny, since I've been treated and have chemotherapy, I've developed a sweet tooth, which of course was catered for amply there.
We've seen some fantastic new foodie venues on our journey so far, but we want our next cook to scream Bristol! So we'll look for inspiration by visiting one of my favourite iconic views, which tells a story spanning back over 250 years.
Look at that behind us, Kingy. Clifton Suspension Bridge. It is one of the wonders of the world. And wow. It took a long time in conception, you know, did it? The first thought of the bridge happened in 1754 when a wine merchant by the name of William Vick, he donated £1,000 to kick it off.
£1,000 then?
Yeah.
Wow.
But nothing happened until 1829, when that £1,000 had come £8,000. So they thought, well, we better start building it. They had a competition for an architect. 22 competed. Eisenberg, Kingdom Brunel, at the age of 24, he got the job.
Eisenberg Kingdom Brunel's bridge remained unfinished at his passing in 1859. Financial setbacks halted his first solo project, which was initially deemed a failure. However, railway engineer John Hawkshaw recognised potential. With his colleague William Henry Barlow, they repurposed links from Brunel's old London footbridge to complete the Clifton Suspension Bridge, restoring Brunel's reputation.
And it really was his baby. But when it was opened, there was 150,000 people turned out for the ceremony.
Wow.
But the bridge, if you think about it, it was designed for very little traffic. It's still working today with all the modern traffic.
It's pretty impressive. And architecturally, it's beautiful.
Yeah. Well, originally, it was designed with kind of like Egyptian sphinxes and everything on it, which was a fashion of the time. But the costs, it didn't. It was simplified. But some ways, I think it's a better for it. It's timeless.
When I think of the bridge celebration, I wonder about the sweet treats Bristolians would have enjoyed at the time. And I've found the perfect way to recreate that very experience with a recipe specifically invented, allegedly, to commemorate that incredible event.
I've found a treat, Kingy.
Have you?
In the annals of history.
Oh, no.
Yeah. What? It's sweet, it's delicious, it's the Clifton Puff.
Right.
The Clifton Puff is an interesting, tasty treat.
Yes.
You chop those while you're waiting.
Right.
Right. It is said, it may be an urban myth, that around 1864, that the Clifton Puff was distributed to celebrate the bridge. Then, in 1954, Dorothy Hartley, in her book Food in England, wrote a recipe for the Clifton Puff.
You know, you worry me sometimes about the things you read.
Well, what it is, it's like a sweet mincemeat puff pastry parcel, a little one. And it's like a little puff, so it's just one bite, one mouthful, and we're going to make about 20 of them. So we start off, we chopped almonds. They go in there.
In the pan?
Oh, yes. Okay. So what we're going to do is macerate this lot down with brandy. You like that?
Happy days!
Right, it's lovely, this.
There we are.
You cut up the orange peel, candied. It's just the ready rolled puff pastry.
There's nothing wrong with that.
I'm going to square my pastry off because I'm a pedantic old swine.
Is that a ruler?
Yes. Every kitchen should have one, you know, for pastry work.
While Si finally chops the almonds and candied orange peel, I can begin shaping the pastries.
Dates. They've already been pitted. It's fun finding old recipes and revitalising them.
Giving them a little bit of a hairy baker's twist.
Oh, yes.
Anything else to be chopped?
Yes. Two apples, peeled, cored and diced finely.
Toss in those currants, sultanas and sliced apples. Add a touch of richness with ground almonds, a decent amount of brown sugar and a sprinkling of cinnamon.
And there's one more ingredient that takes it to the next level, Kingy.
Ooh.
A dash of almond extract.
Finally,
good.
Brandy.
Ooh.
Do you want to? No, you'll drink it. Oh, Kingy, I forgot.
What?
I want some lemon zest, mate.
OK.
Not all of that.
Add that zest for a burst of citrus. Then bring the heat up a little and let it simmer to combine all of those wonderful, rich flavours.
Right, mate. Do you know, it smells very Christmassy in here, doesn't it?
It does.
Peel and cinnamon.
That's it done. We just need to let it cool.
Of course, because if I start to roll up me Clifton Puffs, it's just going to melt the pastry.
Which is no good at all.
Not at all.
Because it'd be a Clifton sag then.
Oh, and to avoid that calamity, make sure you do let the contents cool. Maybe grab a quick cup of tea.
Now take a square of pastry and you wash.
Around the sides. Ooh, nice.
Yeah. So, you take the two corners together like so, like a pocket handkerchief. Seal it. Take the other one up. Seal it. Take this one up like so.
It's like the Great Pyramids.
Now that, just straighten it up, is a perfectly formed Clifton Puff.
That's brilliant.
All I need to do is repeat.
Looks like we've got our work cut out for us. That's a lot of Cliftons to shape. Remember to be generous with the eggy wash for a crispy golden finish.
Look at them, eh?
Lovely.
Eggy wash, please. I'll sprinkle with sugar now, Kingy, to caramelise.
All right, lovely.
Bake at 180 degrees Celsius for 20 minutes.
Beauty.
And then take out and serve your Clifton Puff, hot or cold.
Oh, look at that, a taste of paradise from the past.
Oh, they're lovely, actually.
They are, aren't they?
Mm-hmm. Good.
Reminds me a bit of dead fly pie when I was a kid.
Yeah.
You know, the blackcurrant slice?
Yeah.
Oh, lovely, with a cup of tea. A little homage to Bristol.
Nice to be back on the Severn, actually. It's quite nostalgic, wasn't it, for us?
What a wonderful way to end our journey around the West Country. The trip provided a medley of flavours and brought back sweet memories.
Oh.
As well as creating some new ones.
The sun's come out for us as well.
Thank you.
What could be better, mate?
You. Nothing.
Go what? West, life is peaceful there.
Go west,
lots of open air.
I think that's the lovely thing about this part of the world. It's entrenched in very old and ancient British history. And the scenery is just spectacular, isn't it, really?
It's the most wonderful snapshot of the West Country. You know, this part, you know, we started off in Newport. I didn't know that Newport was a foodie destination. Of course, we get into Bristol, and then the world just opens. You know, there's memories here, a lot of memories for both of us. But what's lovely is the optimism of looking forward, and certainly on the food front, it's very, very exciting and very optimistic. We've got the best of the past and the best of the future.
Next time,
the West Country, Kingy. We've made it.
We're on the final leg of our journey out west.
Exploring beautiful Devon and Dorset.
Ooh, it's like going on my holidays.